It's a way of life in New York that organized crime has under their control union officials. They are just a tool to make money. By having control over the union, you exercise control over the entire industry. I don't just mean truck drivers. I mean waitresses, waiters, bartenders, construction workers. Every form of labor is totally controlled by organized crime in the New York metropolitan area. And I mean the mafia by organized crime.
In the early years of this century, the right of American workers to belong to unions was won only after long and violent strikes. The robber barons of American industry banned unions from their factories. Whenever workers went on strike, employers hired gangs of thugs or goons to crush them. The unions decided to fight violence with violence by hiring gangsters.
Well, we'd go to these strikes and you'd fight. And they had picket lines, and at that time you could fight, you know, and the cops wouldn't do nothing. And then the parking lots, like I say, I threw acid on cars. The transportation driver, same thing. We'd ruin their cars, put sugar in, or, you know, whatever, trucks, you know. That's it. I mean, I did a lot of work for him, you know, when I was a kid.
In the frequent strikes of the 1920s, protecting union pickets became a profitable business for gangsters like Jimmy Fratiano.
The first one, the Secretary Treasurer called me and said, Jimmy, bring me 10 guys, you know. So I would pay him $5 apiece. I would get $15 for every person. Now, for me, I'd get 50 a day. For on the picket line. I would get 15 for each one I had. So I'd give them $5 and I'd keep 10. So other guys would do the same thing from their neighborhood, you know, would bring 10. Well, maybe we'd have 100, 150 guys, tough guys, you know, guys that could handle their dukes, see? And that's the way they used to work it in them days. You would hire. I would bring kids, you know, guys 18, 19 years old. And that's the way it worked.
Strikes turned into bloody wars as the heavies on both sides battled it out. These strikes only served to strengthen the links between the gangsters and the unions.
And how did this affect the growth of the union?
Well, they'd win the strike. You know what I mean? And eventually that the more members they got. But they was always did good for the working class. You know, they always got them good money and got them raises. The mob started these unions from the ground floor in the 20s.
It was on the waterfront of New York that the mob first took over a major union. The entire port could be brought to a standstill by the International Longshoremen's Association, the ILA, to which all dockers belonged. Through the shape-up, the mob ruled every longshoreman. When a ship came in, longshoremen seeking work had to shape up by forming a crowd around a hiring boss who had the sole power to hire labor on his pier. Anyone who wanted to work had to hand over part of his pay as a kickback to the hiring boss. The mob further exploited the longshoremen with their gambling and money-lending rackets. The mob ruled through violence and murder. The men who challenged them could end up in the river. Sometimes the victims were rival gangsters. Usually they were longshoremen who dared to speak out against the mobsters who ran the union.
There was a lot of rough stuff going on. Mike Brogan was found dead in the river during the middle of our campaign. And newspapers come up, and I told them he was probably killed down there.
Murdered?
Murdered. And the detectives come up, wanted to know how the hell I knew that he was murdered. I said, the same way that you said it was accidental. How the hell do you know it was accidental? I still say he was murdered. After 30 years working on a waterfront, you just don't fall in a river. You know your way around.
Johnny Dwyer became a longshoreman in 1937. His fight against the mob inspired the film On the Waterfront and the character played by Marlon Brando. Dwyer led the campaign to rid the union of its gangster bosses.
They represented the whole waterfront. What they said, whatever came out of 14th Street, which was the ILA headquarters, that was it. That was the law. And for years and years, nobody dared question what they said, even when they told you you could only get a nickel raise.
The union's bosses operated behind a front of respectability.
They were the three-piece suit criminals, I would call them. You know, you would never take them for criminals because it was all done in a back room. Nothing done. If they wanted to beat somebody up, they sent somebody else down to do it.
In the Brooklyn section of New York, Anthony Anastasia, Tough Tony, was the boss of the ILA. His power came not from his union rank, but from his high standing in the Mafia. His rackets were often investigated, but he always came out proclaiming his innocence.
Did they give you a bad time in there?
There was the most bunch of gentlemen I ever met in my life.
We know you have a right to refuse to sign, Tony, but we're wondering the reason.
You have a right to tell us what you said legally.
Believe me sincere. Believe me sincere. They treat me as a gentleman, and I answer every question as a gentleman to them.
Have you been asked to come back again?
No, sir. No?
Tony, you said some things about the investigation when you went in. Why have you changed your mind? Now you won't talk about it.
You see, when a man is no stealing, a man is no taking no kickback, a man is no committing a crime and never got to worry about.
Tough Tony was a captain in the Mafia family led by his notorious brother Albert. For 30 years, Albert Anastasia was the Mafia's most ruthless enforcer, the head of its assassination squad, Murder Incorporated. Albert would come to a fitting end, shot with such force that he was blown out of a barber's chair. The Mafia dons who ordered his death simply took over his rackets, but the continuing violence led to demands from press and public to clean up the waterfront. Now the longshoremen dared to protest against the mob's control over their livelihoods. They went on strike, not against the employers, but against their own union. Even Tough Tony Anastasia had to take shelter in the middle of his band of supporters. The longshoremen who ridiculed Tough Tony protested that the union bosses were taking bribes from the employers to keep longshoremen's wages low. They tried to get Tony voted out of the leadership and clear the waterfront of his mafia heavies. The rebels won so much support that they finally forced New York's politicians to move against the mob in the union. In 1953, a waterfront commission was set up to govern the port of New York. The commission was given the power to license anyone who worked on the waterfront and to expel crooked union officials from the piers. One of its first moves was to abolish the shape-up and end the mob's control over who got work. Now jobs were handed out in hiring halls by the commission's own officials. At last, longshoremen had something to smile about. They no longer had to pay kickbacks to get work, and their wages rose. It looked as if the commission really could clean up the port. But as fast as it threw mobsters off the waterfront in New York, the mobsters found other ports to exploit. In the 1960s, the ports of Florida began to boom. Miami had been a small harbor for local Caribbean shipping until 1964, when a huge new facility opened on Dodge Island, purpose-built for ocean-going vessels. Miami was no longer just a sleepy banana port. It was becoming the cruise capital of the world, and its huge cargo terminal was making it one of America's busiest transatlantic harbors. In the 1960s, the Eagle Steamship Agency decided to take advantage of the opportunities opened up by Dodge Island. It was a family business, handling cargo and carrying out ship repairs.
When she's finished, we need to start loading lumber.
It was run by Joey Teitelbaum. His family had been in shipping in Miami for generations. It was a port with no history of mob activity.
All this is all taken care of? All right, I'm gonna walk around here just to make sure you get it all done, all right? Hey, Jack! Make sure all those containers from Majestic Lines, the ones that are sealed, are put in the...
Business boomed for Joey until he was visited by labor racketeers who told him they were starting a new union for cargo checkers. The men were George Barone, expelled from the New York docks for running a crooked union, Bill Boyle, another mobster from New York, and the longshoreman's leader, Fred Field, who told the Teitelbaum family their cargo checkers would have to join the new union.
My father asked Freddie Fields, what checkers union are you talking about? He said, the new one that we just formed. And you people will sign a checkers contract. We told him, no, we won't. And Freddie Fields said, listen, you, pointing to me, is there some place we could talk? I understand you're a bright little boy. I told him, sure, let's go fishing. He said, okay. On this fishing trip, Benny Astorino told me that Freddie and his group were here to stay. The checkers union was in Miami. It was a way of life. This was a new port that was opening. Barone was the president. I could become associated with Freddie, and he could give me a lot of business. He wants to be my partner, but I'll have to put up $3,000 to show my good faith. I told him I couldn't make that commitment. I had to check with my father and my uncle. Both my father and my uncle said no, and we adamantly refused to sign that checkers contract. It was right afterwards that Freddie Fields called me on a telephone and said, are you ready to sign, or do I have to break your balls? I told him I wasn't signing. When I got home that evening, my wife was waiting for me outside, really upset. And I asked her, what's wrong? And she said, someone called me and said that we were a nice family. I was a nice lady. He wouldn't want to see our daughter have an accident on the way home from school. Signed the contract. My wife told me, Joe, sign the contract. And we signed a union contract.
The Teitelbaum's problems were only beginning, for the Genovese crime family of New York had realized Miami was the port of the future. Using Barone, Boyle, and Field as their front men, they set out to extort money from the shipping companies on Dodge Island. They did it through their new checkers union.
We didn't even know who the checkers were. We had never met these so-called checkers. And then a whole group came down from New York, all of Barone's boys. And each company had to hire a head checker. In the warehouse, you had to have two of his union checkers. On the trucks, you had to have two checkers. Before, where we had one man working, we had five and six men working. And they weren't even there half the time. Then they started ghosting. And ghosting means you have a guy on the payroll, but he's never there. And we didn't even know who half these people were. But we were told every week, you make a check out to his name. And we did.
Barone was typical of the mob that had moved in on Miami. He had a shocking record for violence and extortion, but on Dodge Island, there was no waterfront commission to stand in the mob's way.
They had become so powerful in their own right that they controlled a pencil or a toothpick that was delivered to the dock. If you didn't pay, the longshoremen wouldn't load it. They wouldn't even allow your truck on the dock. They controlled the laundries, they controlled the vendors, You had to use their people in container repairs. Whether a container needed a repair or not, you had to have it repaired. They controlled every checker. Theft was rampant. You could not accuse a man of stealing. If you did, everybody walked off the dock. Thievery became a way of life on the waterfront. Their control was so enormous that they would pick up the telephone and call a local president in Mobile and say, Joey Teitelbaum has a ship going into Mobile. You're not to unload it. No labor would show up. Everyone who moved on a dock worked for them. This was the control they had from Searsport, Maine, to Galveston, Texas. Every port in the east coast of the United States and the Gulf.
It took 6 years before the rackets on Dodge Island came to the notice of the FBI and Florida's own investigators. From their headquarters in Miami, agents, detectives, and lawyers began to build up a case.
In 1973, a combined federal, state, and local task force was formed to look into organized crime's influence into the transportation industry, and specifically into the shipping industry. What we found was that a number of people, specifically George Barone, Fred Fields, and others, who had been banned from the docks in New York for corruption and organized criminal activity, were in our community. And what we needed was someone who had direct inside information as to how the payoffs were taking place, how the corruption was taking place, and exactly how organized crime had infiltrated the union. Joey Teitelbaum was such a person. And we were successful in making a criminal case against Mr. Teitelbaum. At the conclusion of that criminal case, he agreed to cooperate with us, and he did so.
Joey had to cooperate. The criminal case brought against him was conspiracy to murder. It involved a business partner who had stolen money, food, and medical supplies that Joey was sending to a charity in Latin America. In a fit of outrage, Joey hired a hitman to kill him.
Get your goddamn hand on it and land that box.
The hitman was an FBI informer who exposed Joey's plans.
About that time, I got in a little trouble. I'd taken out a contract on somebody in South America. I got arrested.
Come on in the rough.
Police came to me. Said to me, we don't want you. We want these guys on Dodge Island. But we've got you by the ass. And how do you want to play this game? I said, okay, let's deal. They told me what they wanted. They wanted in on Dodge Island. And I told them, I walk from the other one. They said, it's a deal. So a deal was made. And they said, how far can you take us? And I said, how far do you want to go? They said, all the way to the top. I told them, hang on for the ride.
As part of this deal, the FBI planted three undercover men in Teitelbaum's shipping company. The FBI agents saw at first hand the payoffs the mobsters were demanding from Joey. The racketeers were now so powerful that they could dictate who did business with whom on the waterfront.
George Barone came to see me with Bill Boyle, and they told me, you want the Zim contract? I told him, yes. It's cost you $15,000 up front. In addition to the $15,000, you have to pay us 50 cents a ton on the loose cargo, $12 a box, and 1% of your revenue. I told him, that's a heavy price. He said, that's it. I told him, okay, let me think about it. I got in contact with this FBI agent who I was working with, told him I wasn't going to pay this money. And he said, pay it. We'll front it.
The FBI gave Joey the money to make the payoffs. They also hid a microphone on his body to record each transaction. Joey made one payoff without any problems. The next nearly cost him his life.
A week or so later, I went to make another payoff. And during the time of making this payoff, the FBI agent who strapped the recorder onto my thigh didn't tie it on fast enough. It fell down. And they said, what's this? I said, oh, my God, my portable pacemaker. So I took the money out of my pocket and gave it to him and says, you count the money. I've got to go to the doctor, get my pacemaker checked. And I ran out.
I thought that Joey Teitelbaum's life was in danger at the time. There's no doubt that had they known or suspected that it was, in fact, an electronic listening device that they would have probably taken some violent action against Mr. Teitelbaum at the time. Joey had recently suffered a heart attack, and he told him that his pacemaker had fallen out. And I guess they were perhaps the most gullible people I ever met because they must have believed him.
The FBI told me we had to have confirmation of this payoff. So I went back to see Bill Boyle the next day with the tape recorder and said, did you get $1,500? And he shook his head, yeah. And I said, listen, do I speak English or don't I, goddammit? Did you get the fucking $1,500? And he said, I got the $1,500. And I said, thank you very much. That was the confirmation we needed.
Teitelbaum's evidence cracked open the entire waterfront conspiracy. The FBI rounded up more than 20 mobsters and corrupt businessmen involved in extortion, embezzlement, and bribery. They were all convicted. Among them, George Barone, the overlord of extortion in America's southern ports, jailed for 15 years. Bill Boyle, who dictated how dozens of shipping lines did business, jailed for 12 years. And the union's top national organizer, Fred Field, jailed for 6 years. The evidence proved all three were frontmen for the Genovese crime family. The Miami convictions were followed by 10 more racketeers being convicted in New York. It was the most successful case ever made against organized crime. But on Joey's dock, bodyguards with concealed weapons have had to protect the FBI's star witness ever since his role as an informer was revealed. The government wanted him to leave Miami and live under a new identity. He refused. The Mafia still wants to kill him.
We were required to provide 7-day-a-week, 24-hour-a-day protection for Mr. Teitelbaum and his family, which included parking marked police vehicles at his home, following his children, following his wife, taking him to his office and to his business, until such time as the federal government was able to bring in United States Marshals to take over this particular procedure. I do know that there have been documented threats, and in fact, documented attempts to take his life. He still has 24-hour protection.
Make sure you take care of
him. Today, Joey's shipping company is booming again. He's determined to stay in Miami and run his business, whatever the risk to his life.
Together and everything? All right.
I run that dock of mine with an iron hand. That's my dock. No gangsters are going to run it for me. I run it myself. Win, lose, or draw. Gangsters tried to get on my dock since I formed it. I'm not ashamed to tell you, I ran them off with a pistol. If they ever come to my dock, they better come looking to kill me, because I'll kill them first.
America, land of the free, home of the brave. Fine-sounding phrases, but they mean little when the Mafia goes to work. Even the New York skyline is a monument to the mob. Nothing gets built in this city unless organized crime takes its cut. On New York's tallest towers, the Mafia extorts millions of dollars through its control of the construction unions. In recent years, dozens of labor leaders fronting for the mob have been jailed for racketeering. They were the crooked bosses of unions representing the carpenters, laborers, masons, electricians, plumbers, painters, plasterers, and the men who build tunnels for the subway, the sanders and blasters. America has the biggest construction industry in the world. It employs hundreds of thousands of highly paid workers, and any delays can cost millions. To keep men at work and supplies moving, employers are often forced to give in to the mob's demands. If they don't, they'll soon be hit by slowdowns, strikes, sabotage, even murder. Across America's mighty industrial economy, the labor racketeers abuse the power of the unions to force payoffs from employers and to steal from their own union members. But the mob realized a long time ago that one industry governed the fate of all the others, transportation. In this vast country, almost everything has to be moved by road. It's the truck drivers who keep America moving. Their union, the Teamsters, was founded 90 years ago by men who drove teams of horses. Today, the union has 2 million members. 500,000 of them drive America's trucks and transporters. The drivers' pension and welfare funds add up to billions of dollars. That money has been the target of the Mafia. It's made a fortune riding on the back of the truck drivers and the trucking companies of America. The man who made the Teamsters America's biggest and wealthiest union was Jimmy Hoffa, an Indiana farm boy who moved to Detroit. He led his first strike at 19, and by the time he was 23, was a union leader. For 30 years, Hoffa's power base was Teamster Local 299 in Detroit. Most of his members worked as drivers serving the city's car plants, and most loved Jimmy.
If we had three or four more Hoffas in this country, that would be all we need.
He is really the man.
From the 1940s, Hoffa recruited thousands of drivers to the Teamsters, building a huge personal following in the industrial cities of the Midwest.
Hey, Jimmy, when you get through the head, give it to me. I think I could use it on myself. Don't worry about me.
Through Local 299, he became a national figure in the union. At the union's convention in Miami in 1957, Hoffa was the only serious candidate for president. His glad-handing style won him many votes, as did his brilliant record for getting his members the best wages. The delegates cheered and stomped for Hoffa. He was now the most powerful union leader in America.
Taken here today by the delegates in a free and democratic election and selecting me as the president of this international union.
Hoffa had been put into the presidency not in a free and democratic election, but by gangsters who controlled many of the delegates. Hoffa's close links with organized crime became a public scandal. In 1958, they were exposed by the Senate Rackets Committee in Washington. Hoffa came under fire from Robert Kennedy for allowing criminals to rule Teamster locals.
You've got people in Detroit, at least 15, who have police records. You've got Joey Glimko in Chicago. I say you're not tough enough to get rid of these people then.
Well, I don't propose to
You haven't moved
tough.
Against any of them.
I don't propose to act tough, and I will follow the Constitution of the International Union. And in due time, the situations where necessary will be corrected. I don't frighten too easy.
Well, you're not.
I don't intend to have the impression left, as been stated publicly, that I'm controlled by gangsters. I am not controlled by them, but by the same token.
To Robert Kennedy and the Senate Rackets Committee, it was obvious Jimmy Hoffa was controlled by gangsters. Gangsters controlled many of the local unions and the votes which had made him president. The Teamsters' national organization is divided into regional councils. In America's industrial heartland, these councils were ruled, directly or indirectly, by made members of the Mafia. Nick Savella controlled both the crime family and the Teamsters in Kansas City. Joey Glimko ran the union for the Mafia bosses of Chicago. Anthony Jackalone had been Hoffa's ally from the 1940s and had helped him build his power base in Detroit. John Scalish was the Mafia boss whose underlings ran most of the Teamster locals in the steel town of Cleveland. Johnny DioGuardi was a capo in the Genovese crime family in New York. He fixed the Teamsters' votes in the city to make sure Hoffa was elected president. But Mafia power in the Teamsters was at its most blatant in the blue-collar towns of New Jersey, where no less than 7 Mafia families operate. In Hudson County, the Teamster Local 560 had 10,000 members working in trucking, factories, and retail stores. Local 560 was controlled by the Genovese crime family through Anthony Provenzano, known to all as Tony Pro. In public, especially at election times, Tony Pro projected the image of the popular union leader, a humble truck driver who had made it to the top of the Teamsters. Provenzano's supporters in Local 560 felt they shared his glory as a Teamster vice president. But Tony Pro did not take the job to serve their interests. He exploited what was the biggest local in the union, not for the truckers of New Jersey, but for his Mafia family. Tony Pro was Jimmy Hoffa's closest ally. Both men profited from the union's remarkable growth.
My friends, the Teamsters is a strong and powerful union. In the last decade, our members have tripled. Through the leadership of our general president, James R. Hoffa, and its executive board. We represent approximately 2 million American citizens.
Provenzano played the respectable union leader, but the real Tony Pro was known only to men like Ralph Picardo, a mafioso who's now a government informer. In fear of his life, Picardo agreed to talk only if he were heavily disguised. He came to know Provenzano only too well.
Tony was a ruthless, self-educated, cunning, schizophrenic. He always treated ambitious people, whether the ambition was directed for his benefit or not, as people that were trying to take over his power, his domain. He had them killed. And in two cases, he had his rivals or potential rivals killed when they could have been dealt with in a different way.
Talk about those killings.
Particularly the Castellito murder. Castellito was murdered because he had popularity amongst the membership, which Tony didn't have, and that Tony was totally paranoid that Castellito would control the union at one point, Local 560. So he had him murdered when he became a threat to run against Mr. Provenzano. And Mr. Provenzano repeatedly bragged about how he had Mr. Castellito killed, and that if I had any ambitions similar to him, that my grave was already dug.
The grave meant for Ralph Picardo was at a chicken farm in New Jersey. Police later dug up the remains of several bodies. This was certainly a mafia graveyard, as Picardo learned from another mobster, Fred Farino.
Mr. Farino and myself were down at Joe Celso's chicken farm. And while we were at the farm, Mr. Farino showed me graves, empty graves where people had not been put in, and told me about numerous other graves that were on the property, and that his farm was used for a period of years by the Genovese family and Mr. Provenzano to put and bury people that they didn't want found.
The graveyard showed the Mafia would kill to protect its rackets in the Teamsters Union. Jimmy Hoffa was more than happy to go along with his Mafia friends. Tony Pro had backed Hoffa for president. In return, Provenzano plundered the funds of the union locals in New Jersey.
Do you think Hoffa had any idea that Provenzano was a made member of the Mafia?
Oh, without a doubt he knew. He knew exactly who Anthony Provenzano was. He knew he was a made member. He knew he was closely associated all his life with the Genovese family and a made member of it. When he awarded them the general charter for Teamsters Local 84, and when he made him an international vice president. He was well aware of it.
Jimmy Hoffa's connections with mobsters like Provenzano were his undoing. After 10 years under incessant investigation, he was finally jailed in 1967 for misusing millions of dollars from union funds.
Tell me, my lawyers will take care of my business.
By putting Hoffa in prison, the government did not rid the Teamsters of organized crime. The Mafia only tightened its control over the union and its leadership once Hoffa was out of the way. The Teamsters now had a new president, Frank Fitzsimmons. Hoffa thought Fitz was just a stopgap leader who would stand down for Hoffa when he got out of prison. But the Mafia had more lasting plans for Fitzsimmons. Fitz was their puppet. They didn't need Hoffa anymore. There would be no more cheers for Jimmy. He was freed in 1971 and was determined to get his old job back. The Mafia had other ideas. In 1975, Jimmy Hoffa disappeared from his Detroit home.
My father, James R. Hoffa, has been missing for some 32 hours. He left for an appointment at Max's Red Fox restaurant at approximately 1:30 p.m. Wednesday, July 30, 1975. He called home at approximately 2:15 p.m. We have not heard from him since.
There was no trace of Hoffa at the Red Fox restaurant. Tales that he'd been killed and buried in a forest brought out the search parties, but his body was never found. One story said the Mafia had stuffed the dead Hoffa in an oil drum and then put the drum through a car crusher. Did the mob kill Hoffa because he wanted to become Teamster president again? Former Mafia boss Jimmy Fratiano has no doubts.
I think the reason he was killed, that he was trying to go around the country and run against Fitzsimmons. He was doing it on his own. They didn't want him to run. They were happy with Fitzsimmons. So that's the reason they killed him. He wouldn't stop.
Down in Florida, newsmen tried to speak to one of the main suspects, Tony Pro. Tony Pro was supposed to meet Hoffa the day he disappeared, but he had a perfect alibi. He was 600 miles away on union business.
How you into the Hoffa disappearance and wondered if you had some reaction?
I have no knowledge of his disappearance. I haven't seen Jimmy since November of 1970. And I don't know where he is. I'm as shocked as anybody else is. This is my resident. My family lives with
Tony Pro had quarreled bitterly with Hoffa after the mob had decided he would never be Teamster president again. But Tony tried to convince reporters investigating the Hoffa disappearance that he and Jimmy had remained the best of friends.
How close a friend are you?
Jimmy? Jimmy and I have known each other for 25 years. We come up the ladder the same way, as a truck driver. Jimmy's a warehouse, maybe as a truck driver.
All right.
What's your telephone
it's
number?
It's embarrassing. You're looking at me like I'm a mobster. And I'm not. I'm a truck driver. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But Tony Pro was a mobster, and he ran his New Jersey locals as a Mafia bank. Loans were freely made to other mobsters from the union pension funds and never repaid. Local 560's headquarters also housed Tony Pro's brothers, to whom he gave top union jobs. But the biggest racket was extorting money from employers, not on behalf of working Teamsters, but for the private gain of the mafiosi who ran the local. In the 1970s, Tony Pro was holding shipping companies on the Hudson River to ransom. His mafia henchmen forced the companies into submission through a campaign of systematic sabotage. The man who was masterminding the sabotage was Ralph Picardo.
Well, and particularly, we'd dump graphite in the motor oil and engines would seize up. Refrigerated units would be turned from cooling off if it was to cool the merchandise to freeze, so the merchandise would go bad, or turned on to heat, so the merchandise would, perishables would then perish, and where it couldn't be salvaged. The material would be no good, and in most cases, like it would be meat or produce. Fifth wheel locks were pulled on containers so that trailers would fall off the chassis. Slowdowns on the lines, so it would take hours rather than 15 or 20 minutes to pick up one trailer load of freight. Sometimes it would take a day.
One of the companies, C-Train, was losing so much money because of the sabotage that in desperation its executives ran to the underworld for help. They were told the only man who could help them was Ralph Picardo, who was, of course, the very man orchestrating the sabotage.
They wanted to be relieved of this problem, and they approached me to secure labor peace for them, which I did.
And who did they think they were really dealing with?
Well, they knew they were dealing with somebody that was a representative of Mr. Provenzano, Tony Provenzano. They knew they were dealing with the Mafia and the heads of the Teamsters local. They knew definitely. But they more or less put that in the back of their mind. They tried to leave it on the surface and wanted it always left on the surface to be a legitimate business arrangement.
It was far from legitimate. Picardo was creaming off a fortune by billing the C train company for workers who never turned up.
I was providing bills for men that actually didn't exist. Names would take off a tombstone, a grave, dead people's names, submitting them to C train lines for, as if these particular people supplied a service in a given day, and they would give me checks in return for these the wages that I would bill them for.
Could you say how much money they paid you for these?
Somewhere in the neighborhood of $500,000.
That $500,000 was only a fraction of the money mobsters looted from C-Train. By 1981, C-Train had been bankrupted. Ralph Picardo blames the Mafia.
It's living proof of what labor unions and labor racketeering can do to a lucrative company. The most modern facility in the New York metropolitan area is now vacant. It's not being used. It's a ghost town.
In 1979, Tony Pro was convicted after extorting millions of dollars from C-Train. Today, he's serving 20 years for that crime, plus life for murder. Putting a leading Teamster official like Provenzano in jail is a rare victory. Government investigators have found labor racketeering cases hard to prove, even though the Mafia and the Teamsters have been sweethearts for years, as Jimmy Fratiano knows after 50 years in organized crime.
See what they do. They controlled the vice presidents. They controlled the delegates. You know, they put who they want in there. Like, let's take Cleveland. Let's take Detroit, Chicago, New York. They control it. So, you know, they all got their key men there.
At the union's 1981 convention, one key man was replaced by another. Frank Fitzsimmons had died. He was succeeded as Teamster president by the union's boss in Kansas City.
I am proud to place in nomination the name of the man destined to become the progressive labor leader of the 80s, a man for our times, the next general president of the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, Mr. Roy Lee Williams.
Far from being a progressive labor leader, Roy Williams was wholly owned by the Mafia. This was common knowledge, frequently stated in newspapers and in the Senate, and yet Williams was still elected by a massive majority. Not all members of the union welcomed his election. Rebels outside the hall were protesting at the whole voting system and the intimidation that went with it.
The people are afraid. I mean, you're getting $10, $11 an hour. If you open your mouth, they're right on your back. You're out of a job. Your business agent comes out and tells you, buddy, you got a job. What are you bitching about? And if he goes too far, he'll tell him, you don't even have a job tomorrow now. You got anything else to say? Used to be in the meetings if somebody got up and said something they didn't like. Three or four guerrillas picked him up and put him outside. That simple. There was no cohesion. It was usually an individual would speak up or two and they'd out the door.
At convention time, members demanding a cleanup in the union have problems even getting into the hall. Without official blessing, they don't get past the door. If any protesters do get inside, they have trouble getting heard. Joe Ehrman got inside the 1981 convention with his group of reformers. They soon faced trouble from the Teamster heavies.
Follow us all the time, set us in a certain area. The fear was there, without a doubt. I mean, they had some big gorillas there. You know, and you're not going to oppose. There was something like probably 140 or 50 people in our party, along with the delegates. You know, volunteers, support people, and all that, and guests. But even then, we were just a small drop in the bucket when they got 40 people on a doorway, this train, and this is what they've been doing. Hell, you walked in there like you was going, you had to be a damn good man and to walk in the first place if you was a reformer.
We're voting now on the amendment. Signify by saying aye. Those opposed. Motion is carried. Now,
if you don't go along with the program the way they want it, well, maybe they'll use a little violence. You know, people are scared. They don't want to get hurt. And, I have never seen where they had problems, you know, at any convention that they ever had. Because that's how well controlled it is. There's one guy out of Detroit that always runs against the president, but they think he's a nut. He never wins, he never comes close.
What about the threat of violence all the time?
Well, sometimes you might have to use violence. To get what you want.
Sorry, against the
dissidents. The rank and file, against somebody that's against you all the time. You tell them to lay off, lay off, lay off. You don't do it. Well, maybe you got to go to violence. Have somebody break his legs or something, you know. Not necessarily kill him, but to hurt him.
And it, because he's fighting against organized crime.
That's right.
Organized crime's power in the Union was spelled out yet again in 1982 when Roy Williams was found guilty of conspiring to defraud the Teamsters' pension fund. Convicted with him were some of the most powerful mafia hoodlums in Chicago. Roy Williams was the third Teamster president to be jailed in 25 years and the third who was a creature of the mafia. The new president was Jackie Presser, the union's boss in Cleveland, where the mafia has run Teamster locals for generations. Presser's father was a Teamster boss, convicted of violence, extortion, and labor racketeering. Presser himself has often been accused of mob connections.
Is there organized crime influence in the Teamsters Union?
Not to my knowledge. I still believe that organized crime owners, and again, it's always unnamed sources say.
What about the murder of John Nardi? What about the indictment of Skip Felice? What about the indictment of Tony Liberatore all in Ohio?
Are those all organized crime or are those individual acts
those are organized
of individuals?
Crime figures.
No, they're figures by the media as organized crime. The acts of individuals, Brian, really should not be placed on the shoulders of the officers of the International Brotherhood of Teamsters. It's unfortunate that people have fault, but you really don't paint the entire International Brotherhood of Teamsters with the same paintbrush.
These are men who were murdered in the parking lot of your building in Ohio. These are men who have been gone to prison for murder.
Brian, was I arrested for that? Was I indicted for that? Was I ever mentioned for that?
Mr. Presser, do you feel there's any organized crime influence in the union?
Not to my knowledge.
Did you?
Absolutely not.
Presser now heads what is still America's biggest union. After years of scandal, the Teamsters desperately need an honest leader.
Sincerely promise.
Most sincerely promise.
Upon my brotherly honor.
Upon my brotherly honor.
For 30 years, there has been little honor in the Brotherhood of Teamsters.
My ability.
To the best of my ability.
Perform the duties.
American justice has tried to throw the racketeers out of the union. But every time a Teamster president is convicted and sent to jail, the mafia's power seems only to grow.
You are now the general president.
Does the Teamsters' new president serve his members or the mob?